Well, good morning, church, and welcome to today's online service. We're certainly glad all of you are here with us today. Last week, we celebrated all of you moms out there, and we do hope that you had a wonderful Mother's Day. Here, we've been studying 1 Kings together in the sermon series, What Can We Learn from the Wisest Man in the World? We'll get to today's message shortly, but first, let's commit these next few moments of worship fully over to God as we praise Him, acknowledging that all wisdom comes from Him. Following worship will be today's message, Make a Wish, followed by Eagle's Nest announcements. I hope you enjoy today's service.
Break of dawn, giving blind and sight. proclaim I love for him. Has paid the highest price. He has proven his grace for us. Oh, we will praise him with our lives and proclaim our love for him. Whoa, whoa. And proclaim our love for him. Whoa, whoa. And proclaim our love for him.
Every knee will bow and every tongue confess the name Jesus. Oh, every knee. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our service. In his book, Faith and Doubt, John Ortberg begins chapter 6 by saying, "We are all hopers. We are all creatures who cannot stop wishing. We are four-leaf clover collectors. We wish on the evening star. We tell stories about genies coming out of a bottle to grant three wishes. After a turkey dinner," he says, "my cousin Danny and I used to grab the ends of the wishbone from the turkey and break it in the belief that whoever got the longer piece would get his wish." Now, many of us have done that. Where this came from, we have no idea. The bone didn't do the turkey any good, Ortberg says. He says, "We teach our children to make a wish before they blow out the candles over cake. When my children were small," Ortberg says, "they loved to watch the movie Pinocchio. Especially they loved that little plucky, chirpy, irrepressible character named Jiminy the Cricket. And if you go to the Magic Kingdom of Disneyland, the happiest place on earth, you can still hear him sing, "When you wish upon a star, it makes no difference who you are. Anything your heart desires will come true." You know, "When you wish upon a star." You know, I can't sing it, the key's too high. "Makes a difference who you are. Anything your heart desires will come true." If your heart is in your dream, no request is too extreme when you wish upon a star, as dreamers do. Now, I wish that that were true, pun intended. But you know, and I know, that this is not how life works. You can't just wish upon a star. You can't blow out a candle. You can't pull on a turkey bone to make your wishes come true. And while God doesn't go around like a genie popping out of a lamp in the Bible telling us to make a wish, Psalm 37:4 does tell us that God wants to give us what our heart wishes for. When it says, "Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart." Today, we continue in our series, What We Learn from the Wisest Man in the World, Solomon. In 1 Kings chapter 3, Solomon is firmly established on the throne, and God comes to him in a dream of the night and offers him anything he wishes for. And God is so pleased with his wish that God grants it to him. At the end of the chapter, God illustrates, or the Bible writer illustrates, how God made good on this promise to give Solomon wisdom when two women come before Solomon claiming to be the mother of the same baby. So today we're going to talk about, how do you get God to grant you a wish? Well, 1 Kings chapter 3, verses 1 through 3 tell us that Solomon delighted in the Lord, just as Psalm 37:4 told us. You know, before we get into the scripture, I do like to share a little genie joke. A man was walking down the beach and picked up a very old bottle. And so he rubbed it and to remove the sand. And a genie popped out and said, "You can have one wish." The man thought for a minute and said, "Make it so all women will love me." Poof, in an instant, a man was changed into a bar of chocolate. Let's go to the Bible. 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 1. Now, Solomon made a treaty with Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and married Pharaoh's daughter. And then he brought her to the city of David, which is Jerusalem, until he had finished building his own house and the house of the Lord and the wall around Jerusalem. Meanwhile, the people sacrificed at the high places because there was no house built for the name of the Lord until those days. And Solomon loved the Lord, walking in the statutes of his father David, except that he sacrificed and burnt incense at the high place. The Bible tells us three things about Solomon here. First of all, in verse 1, it tells us that Solomon made a treaty with Egypt by marrying Pharaoh's daughter. Now, some scholars say that this means that Solomon was already beginning to compromise his values and his beliefs by marrying a woman from Egypt. But in reality, the law of Moses never forbids such marriages. And so I don't think that that's the intent of the writer here. The point that the writer is making is that Solomon is now established as the king of Israel to the point that Israel's greatest rival, which is Egypt, now recognizes him as the current king of Israel, and also powerful enough that they want to make an alliance with him through marriage. And this was quite common in those days. It will be a problem later in the book, but that's not what I think the author is really trying to do here. He's trying to establish the fact that Solomon is established on the throne and he's being recognized not only internally, as we saw in chapters 1 and 2, but also externally by other nations. Remember, we learned a couple weeks ago to look at the context as well as the content of a story. And the context is Solomon chapter 1 and 2 is established on the throne, and now he's beginning to be recognized by the other nations. In verse 2, it tells us that people worshiped at the high places. In other words, there was no central place of worship. And this was a big problem for the nation of Israel. And it's one of the things that we're going to see God is going to take care of in the reign of Solomon. But overall, the writer is telling us, and he's setting the stage for the building of the temple by Solomon in the next few chapters. In verse 3, it tells us that Solomon loved the Lord by walking in his statutes. This is a way of saying that Solomon is following the commandments of the Lord as given in the law of Moses, which is the first five books of the Bible. And when it says that Solomon sacrificed at the high places, again, there are certain people that believe or scholars that believe are kind of critical of Solomon, saying, again, he's compromising. But I don't believe that's the point the writer's trying to make. The point the writer's trying to make here, in my estimation, and in contextually, is he's trying to set the reader up to know that what's coming next is the building of the temple and that the need was there because even Solomon the king could not go to a central place of worship. He had to go to a high place, which they're never spoken of well in the Bible. And so there's a great need for centralized worship. Now, the Bible goes on to tell us here that Solomon is going to get his heart's desire. And we'll read that in just a few minutes. But Solomon is going to get his heart's desire because his heart's desire is to please the Lord. And so what we're seeing is the fulfillment of Psalm 37:4 when it says, delight yourself in the Lord and he shall give you the desires of your heart. That word delight means to take pleasure in or be sensitive to. So he's saying be sensitive to the Lord and what he desires and the Lord will grant you your heart's desire. So Solomon's heart was delighting in the Lord. The heart, as we've learned in many other messages of mine, the heart is central, is a central core of our being. It's the place where the desires of our spirit, soul, and body intersect. And so when it says Solomon was young, it's telling us that he had a heart for the Lord. His spirit, soul, and body were focused on the Lord, and he was trying to do as God would have him to do. And so as we look at this, we want to remember that God is going to give Solomon a wish, but he's not a genie. God is not a genie. And sometimes people kind of treat God like he's a genie that's there to grant us our wishes, and he really isn't. And that's not the point the Bible's making. But it does tell us that God gave Solomon his heart's desire. And the reason why is that Solomon's desires, the desires of his heart, were aligned with the Lord's. And so Solomon loved the Lord. And loving the Lord means putting his wishes, God's wishes, ahead of our own. It says in 1 John chapter 3, verse 22, and whatever we ask, we receive from him. Wow, think about that. And whatever we ask, we receive from him. Why? Because we keep his commandments. We're back to the commandments of the Lord, back to pleasing the Lord. And it says, and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. Notice the two conditions. The first is that we keep his commandments, and the second is that we do those things which please him. Now, somewhere along the line, American Christianity has turned things upside down. We've turned the good news of the gospel into God in that we are given the ability through Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit to please God. We've turned that around to some degree in our culture, in at least cultural Christianity, and turned it around to where God works to do what we desire, to please us, and that's not the gospel. The truth is that God is not a genie desiring to grant us wishes, though he is a God that loves us and wants to give us the desires of our heart. But the condition is that our heart's desires must be aligned with his. And that's what happens here in the story of Solomon. As we've seen, Solomon is walking in the statutes of the Lord in verse 3, and now we pick it up in verse 4, and we see that Solomon delighted in the Lord. We read that he so delighted in the Lord that when the Lord comes on the scene to ask him his wish, God grants it to him. You know, that reminds me of another genie joke. A young man fell into a pit. By the way, I got another one. We're trying to lighten this up a little bit, but because we're talking about getting the desires of our heart and have our wishes granted. And so we just want to kind of lighten it up this morning. But a young man fell in the pit one day and found a magic lamp with a genie inside of it. Of course, the genie popped out and said, I will grant you three wishes. The man's first wish was to get out of the pit. Poof. He was instantly transported out. He then wished for all the gold in the world. Poof! He got all the gold nuggets in the world and all the bars of gold in the world and all the gold pebbles, everything. The man could not think, however, of his third wish, so he went out for a ride in his Ferrari. And so as he's riding in his Ferrari, he turns up the radio, and after a few minutes, a catchy song comes on the radio, and he started to sing along, and it went like this. Oh, I wish I were an Oscar Mayer wiener. And poof, he's a hot dog. I know that's not a very good joke, but it's the best I could find. In 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 4, Solomon demonstrates his love, his devotion, and his delighting in the Lord by offering 1,000 burnt offerings on the altar, which, by the way, was the altar of Moses, at the high place of Gibeon. It says in verse 4, now the king went to Gibeon to sacrifice there, for that was the great high place. That was the biggest one and the most familiar and recognized in the land of Israel. And Solomon offered 1,000 burnt offerings on that altar. Now, the burnt offering was a special kind of offering in Israel. It doesn't mean a lot to us, but back in those days, it meant it was a symbol of a person's total dedication to the Lord. In modern terms, we would say that Solomon is reading his Bible every day, he's tithing, he's serving in the church weekly, he's feeding the poor, and he's praying. This is a guy that's totally devoted to the Lord. And that's our modern day. But in those days, they would offer a sacrifice, which was totally burnt, to express their devotion to God. Now, this high place, Gibeon, was 7 miles northeast of Jerusalem. And 1 Chronicles chapter 1, verses 3 through 6 tell us why it was the great high place. It was because the tabernacle of Moses, which was built 400 years earlier, 480 years to be exact, and the bronze altar were also there. And so these were symbols of what God had done in the past. And of course, Moses, the great lawgiver, was well known in Israel. And so Solomon went there to express his dedication and his devotion to the Lord, and also to illustrate for the nation that he was going to serve God. And because the bronze altar of offering was there, he offered those sacrifices on that altar. And by doing so, he's making a clear statement to everybody. He's saying that the Lord is his God, and he is going to serve him, and he's also the God of Israel. So as he's dedicating himself to the Lord through burnt offerings and his worship, he's also dedicating the nation of Israel to the Lord God of Israel. He's saying, we are committed to you, Lord. We're going to follow you and walk in your ways. And that's why 1 Chronicles chapter 1, verse 3 tells us that he didn't go alone. If you read that story there, he went with a lot of people, and he made it a big deal. This is not just Solomon sneaking up in the night and offering 1,000 bulls or burnt offerings on the altar of offering, or burnt offering. This is him as a leader taking the whole nation with him and saying, hey, we are committing ourselves to follow the Lord, just as his father David had challenged him in chapter 2. And so, and then he goes on to tell us in verses 6 through 9 that God, as Solomon demonstrated his devotion to God through his 1,000 offerings and by going to Gibeon, God demonstrates his love and devotion by offering Solomon a wish. It says in verse 5, at Gibeon, the Lord appeared in a dream by night, and God said, and this is to Solomon, ask what I shall give you. A covenant is a type of relationship where two parties promise to be faithful to each other, like marriage. Marriage is a covenant. Solomon has shown by going to Gibeon and offering the sacrifices that he's going to keep the covenant of the Lord. Now we see God reciprocating by granting Solomon a wish, because this is the way covenant works. The way covenant works is that when you're in a covenant, like in marriage, when I married my wife, she got everything I have. That's covenant. And I got everything she had, because you're promising in a covenant to be faithful, and you're giving your total self to the other one, and the other one's giving themselves totally to you. And so when Solomon goes to offer these sacrifices, God responds by showing that he is devoted to Solomon and to Israel. And he appears to Solomon in a dream and offers him a wish. He says, ask for whatever you want. Now, here's the question. If you were asked by God, what would you wish for? What would you wish for? What would it be? The answer to that question, what would you, if God comes on the scene and says, I'm going to give you whatever you want, what do you want? Whatever the answer to that question is, reveals your heart. It reveals who you are at your deepest core of your being. Now, I'm not talking about just joking. Pastor Jay was showing me a video the other day of people being asked throughout a city what they would wish for. And people came up with all kinds of things, and most of them were frivolous because they weren't really, you know, it's just kind of a joke. But I mean, in reality, if you were asked and you knew you could get whatever you wished for, whatever the answer is to that, whatever your wish is, it's going to reveal who you are at the core of your being. And so Solomon responds to God and his offer of a wish with great humility. Humility, by the way, is not being weak, it's being meek. It's an other focusedness. It's about being more concerned about others than oneself. And so when Solomon acknowledges what the Lord's saying and he responds to him, he does so in humility. And he basically asks for God to give him wisdom. We pick it up in verse 6. And Solomon said, "You have shown great mercy to your servant David, my father, because he has walked before you in truth, in righteousness, and uprightness of heart with you. You have continued this great kindness for him, and you have given him a son," speaking of himself, "to sit on his throne as it is this day. Now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king instead of my father David, and I am a little child." Now, he's not really a child. He's like teenager, maybe in the young 20s. We don't know exactly how old. But he's lowering himself. He's humbling himself. And he says, "I'm just a child in comparison to my father, David, and I do not know how to go out or come in." In other words, I don't know what I'm doing. "And your servant is in the midst of your people whom you have chosen, a great people, too numerous to be numbered or counted. Therefore, give to your servant an understanding heart to judge your people, that I may discern between good and evil. For who is able to judge this great people of yours?" In essence, Solomon's wish, his prayer, is for the ability to lead God's people with justice. And the Lord is so happy with this, because if you study the Old Testament, you'll find that justice and righteousness, and what's ironic is we hear a lot about justice today. And many people don't realize that at the heart of the Old Testament and the heart of the New Testament, at the heart of the Bible, is the message that God is a God of justice and mercy. But he wants justice. He wants people to be treated right. He wants things to be equitable. He wants everybody to be treated with value. That is the underlying theme of the Old Testament. That's why when Micah, the prophet Micah, summarizes the Old Testament in Micah 6:8, he says, "He has shown you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God?" We used to sing this in church all the time back in the day. It would go like this. "He has showed thee, O man, what is good and what the Lord requires of thee but to do justly, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God." Micah summarizes the whole entire Old Testament by saying God loves justice and mercy and humility. And so when God comes on the scene and he asks Solomon what he wishes for, Solomon responds wanting just the ability to administer justice. He's showing humility before his God. And as we saw last week, he had already extended mercy to those that really didn't deserve it. And so God is very pleased. Verse 10 says, "The speech pleased the Lord." I mean, the Lord's happy. God's saying, "That's a great wish." It says that the Lord was pleased that Solomon asked this thing. And then God said to him, "Because you've asked this thing, because you've asked for the ability to administer justice, and have not asked long life for yourself, nor asked riches for yourself," notice the theme, for yourself, "nor have asked of light, the life of your enemies," which would make him secure, "but have asked for yourself understanding to discern justice, behold, I have done according to your works." It's already done, Solomon. It's granted. And as I said, notice the word "yourself." Solomon is not asking for long life. And, you know, in one of the videos that I saw, you know, the guy wants riches, you know, wants gold, you know, silver, he wants a big house, and they want all kinds of things for happiness. Solomon doesn't ask for any of that. God basically sticks a microphone in his face and says, "What do you want, Solomon?" Solomon says, "Lord, I want the ability to administer justice as a king. Not long life, not riches, and not his enemy's life, not getting rid of all his problems. He wants to be able to do justice. And therefore, God grants him his wish. This is an Old Testament illustration of what Jesus taught in the Beatitudes. Jesus says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven," Matthew 5:3. This is a Hebraic way of saying and talking about humility. It's the same thing that's happening here with Solomon. Jesus is saying the kingdom of God, which is all the promises of God and the power of God and God working for us in our lives, is received through humility. And that's what we see in the life of Solomon, at least while he's young. If you travel through the Bible, you'll find from the beginning to the end of it that humility reflects the character and nature of God, which is why God was so pleased with Solomon's request. He wasn't asking for things for himself. He was asking for things for his nation. And I'm finding in my own life that I'm not praying for certain things like I used to. You know, and why? Even some of the spiritual things that I thought I wanted were really about me. And I'm learning as I get older how much things are really about me. And the kingdom of God is not about me. It's not about me. It's about God. And it's about other people. And so I'm trying to learn to pray for things and make my personal list shorter and my prayer list for others longer, because that's the secret to getting your prayers answered. That's the secret to getting wishes from God given to you. Because when we make it about ourselves, God has a hard time giving us what we want, because what we want will often take us off course. And so Solomon is granted his wish. And in 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 15, we find that Solomon awakes from his dream. He realizes it's a dream. Now, back in the time of Solomon and before Solomon, dreams are really important. People put a lot of stock in dreams. Now, we kind of don't do that today, you know, because we eat pizza and we have all kinds of weird dreams. But back in this time, dreams are very important, and it was one of the number one ways that God revealed himself to people is through these dreams. And so a prophetic dream specifically, not just any dream, but a prophetic dream was when God would reveal himself. And so Solomon awakes and he realizes it's a prophetic dream. It's a God-inspired dream. It wasn't that he had pizza that night and, you know, was having a weird dream. It was that God was speaking to him. And so Solomon's response is very telling. Watch what he does. He says, "And then Solomon awoke, and indeed it had been a dream, and he came to Jerusalem." So he's in Gibeah. He gets up and travels 7 miles back to the capital, and he came to Jerusalem and stood before the Ark of the Covenant, because the Ark is separated from the tabernacle of Moses and the altar burning and burnt offering, and it's in Jerusalem, and it's in a tabernacle or a tent built by his father David. And so he makes a beeline for Jerusalem. It says, "And he stood before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord and offered up more burnt offerings and offered peace offerings." Oh, that's a telling thing. "And made a feast for all his servants." Now, before in Gibeon, he had offered burnt offerings, which symbolized his devotion. Now he's offering peace offerings. Peace offerings are the only offering that the worshiper got to eat of, and it is a symbol of fellowship. And so what's happening here is the writer's letting us know that Solomon has gone from somebody who believes in God and is serving the God of his father to now being in a personal relationship with God. And he's experiencing God firsthand. That's what the peace offering was all about. And it's because he loved God. He was following the commandments of God. He was following the advice of his father, as we saw last week. And now God is honoring him with fellowship, and he's enjoying God's presence and fellowshipping with God. And he takes the whole city and he feeds the city in a fellowship way, fellowship peace offering, saying, "We are not only going to serve God, we are going to experience his presence." This is a very beautiful picture that's happening here. Is Solomon is enjoying the very presence of God. And God is granting him his wish. Why? Because his wishes are aligned with God's. His heart is right. Now in the rest of the chapter, in chapter 3, verses 16 through 28, God makes good on his promise and Solomon gets what he wishes for. Which brings me to our third and final genie joke. You know, a guy finds an Aladdin's lamp on the beach. The genie says, "I will grant you 3 wishes. Ask what you want." The man replies, "I want a world without lawyers." Poof. Granted. Then he says, "You have no more wishes left." The man exclaimed, "What do you mean?" He said, you have three wishes. Gigini replied, sue me. Let's go on. Now, this is part of the story is the one that's best known of all the stories of Solomon. Solomon's wisdom is tested here. Let's read a few of these verses found in verse 16. Now, two women who were harlots came to the king and stood before him. And one woman said, oh, my Lord, this woman and I dwell in the same house, and I gave birth while she was in the house. Then it happened the third day after I had given birth that this woman also gave birth, and we were together, and no one was with us in the house except the two of us in the house. So there's no witnesses, okay? Now, what's going to happen here is Solomon is going to have to make a judgment without evidence and without witnesses. Now, this is a test of his wisdom. And so it goes on to say, and this woman's son died in the night because she lay on him. And so she arose in the middle of the night and took my son from my side while your maidservant slept and laid in her bosom and laid her child in my bosom. And when I arose in the morning to nurse my son, there he was, dead. But when I had examined him in the morning, indeed he was not my son whom I had born. Then the other woman said, no, but the living one is my son, and the dead one is your son. And the first woman said, no, but the dead one is your son, and the living one is my son. Thus they spoke before the king. Now, here's what's going on here. Solomon's going to have to give a verdict, and he's going to have to make a decision, but he doesn't have any evidence. So Solomon will use his wisdom, and he's going to quickly produce his own evidence so that he can make a decision. And what he does, he draws on maternal instinct. And so he commands that a sword be brought out and that the child in front of the two women be split in half. Now, a lot of people have heard this story, but I still need to I need to say it again because there's some people may not have heard this story. And I'd really like to encourage you to read chapter 3 of 1 Kings, looking at how Solomon got a dream and also showing, because this is showing how God gave Solomon wisdom, and how God fulfilled his request and gave this man wisdom. Even to the point where when he doesn't even have any evidence, he makes the right decision in judgment and administers justice because he draws on something that's not direct. He draws on maternal instincts. He knows how mothers love their kids. We just celebrated Mother's Day last week. Moms love their kids, and they make sacrifices all the time for their kids. And he draws upon this because he knows that the woman that loves the child who's really the mother of the child, the real mother of the child, her heart will want the child to live. So he brings out this spring sword and says, hey, cut this child in half and give one half to this mother and one half to this other mother. And of course, the woman who's the real mother says, hey, don't do this. Give the child to the other woman, because in her maternal instinct, she wanted her child to live. And of course, the Bible tells us. And so the king answered and said, give the first woman the living child and by no means kill him. She is his mother. Now watch what happens here. Verse 28, and all Israel heard of the judgment which the king had rendered, and they feared or respected the king, for they saw that the wisdom of God was in him to administer justice. Solomon, his heart is aligned with God. His heart's desire is to get wisdom and discernment to be able to administer justice and be a good king in the eyes of the Lord. That desire so pleased God that God said, I'm going to give you your desire. Now we see the writer is illustrating for us how God fulfilled this promise and gave Solomon wisdom. In fact, when God spoke to him, I skipped over this. God said, not only will I give you this thing, but I'm going to do in verse 12, but I'm going to do according to your word, but I have given you wisdom. He says, and I have also given, verse 13, you what you have not asked for. I skipped over that. God says, not only am I going to give you your wish, I'm going to give you what you haven't wished for, both riches and honor, so that there will not be anyone like you among the kings all the days of your life, or all your days. Wow. Then he reminds him, so if you're walking in my ways to keep my statutes and my commandments as your father David walked, then I will lengthen your days. So God's saying, if you'll keep following me, I'm not only going to give you your wish, I'm going to give you what you didn't wish for. This is how God is. God is a generous God, a gracious God. He is not a tightwad God. He is a God that wants to give you your heart's desire, but he doesn't want to give you things that are bad for you, so we need to align our hearts with his. And now at the end of this verse, or at the end of this chapter, the writer is just letting us know that God made good. God fulfilled his promise. Folks, God always fulfills his promise. He always fulfills his promises. If the promises of God aren't working in our lives, don't look at God. We need to look in the mirror. God is a God of His Word. When He promises something, He will give it to us. Now, He does remind us in verse 14 that there are conditions to His promises. And one of those conditions is we walk in His ways. Another is that we delight in the Lord our God. But this story is illustrating for us that God gave Solomon what He promised. He's done according to His words. Now, folks, this is a microcosm of the whole Bible. Throughout the Bible tells us that God delights to give us many things in the desire of our heart. I love Ephesians 3:20, where the New Testament says, "Now to Him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think." God. He said, to Him, God is able to give us exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask. Solomon is an illustration of this. He asked for wisdom. God says, "I give you wisdom, but I'm going to give you riches. I'm going to give you honor. I'm going to give you a long life. I'm going to take care of your enemies because you asked the right thing." And it goes on to say in Ephesians, "According to the power that works in us, to Him be the glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations." That's us. All generations, forever and ever, amen. And this is why God gave Solomon wisdom. He asked the right thing. But as I said, many of God's promises are conditional. Let's remember that we need to walk in His ways, keep His statutes, follow His word. Folks, God isn't a genie. You know, you can't rub the Bible and poof, God's going to come out and say, "I'm going to grant you a wish." That's not how it works. And I think there's too much of that in our culture now. We've turned this thing around where God is our servant. No, we're His servants. But one thing God is God is a gracious and loving and caring God. And He really wants to give us our heart's desire, but He's got to get our hearts right first. And so He begins to work in our lives, as He did in Solomon's, to get our hearts aligned with His. And that's why Jesus Christ came. Jesus Christ came to cleanse our heart and to align our hearts with God, so that when we pray, we can get what we ask for, because our hearts will desire what God desires. Let's pray. Father, I pray for everybody under the sound of my voice that, Lord, You'd cleanse our hearts, that, Father, we would look to Jesus Christ and we would receive from You the forgiveness and grace that we need to, Lord, to get away from looking towards wishes that are not pleasing to You or not aligned with You. But, Lord, help us to align our hearts through Jesus Christ, so that, Father, the wishes and desires that come out of our hearts would be so pleasing to You that You would grant them. And through those, people would be blessed, You would be honored. And, Father, then even then we'd get some things that, Lord, we didn't even ask for, because that's who You are. You always give more exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think. Bless Your people. In Jesus' name, amen. Now join us as we close in worship, followed by Pastor Jay and what's happening here at The Nest.
All I have because of Jesus, all this promise, one for me, when He paid the highest ransom, once for always, for my freedom, I will boast in Christ alone. His righteousness, not my own. I will cling to Christ, my hope. His mercy reigns now and forever. Love will never.
Well, listen, while we're telling genie jokes, I guess I'll have to be up next. So there were three guys that were stranded on a deserted island together. And as they were walking the beach one day, one of them kicked in the sand and discovered that there was a lamp. As they picked it up and rubbed it and cleaned it off, of course, a genie popped out. Because there were three guys, the genie says, "I'll give you one wish each." The first man quickly said, "Man, I really miss my wife, my kids, my family. I gotta get back to them." And poof, he was gone. The second guy's up to bat and he was thinking, "Man, I used to have a really great career before I got stranded on this island. I wanna go back to my career. I've got a lot of goals and things that I wanna pick up as well." And poof, there he went, back to the office. Well, the third guy sits down and he goes, "Man, I don't know what I wanna wish for. Actually, I kind of wish my two friends were here so I could figure it out." And poof, they reappeared. "Hey, that's the best I can do for you. Here we go with the announcements. I don't know what your wish is this morning, but I know we can all have some innocent fun imagining the genie in the lamp who can grant us endless wealth or world peace or some other desire of the human heart. When we read 1 Kings, however, especially in chapter 3, we can learn exactly why God honors this wish and the heart's desire of King Solomon. 1 Kings tells us that Solomon had pure motives. He loved the Lord. He kept his commandments and he desired to please God in everything that he did. So his heart's desire was to honor God and have wisdom to lead his people under his kingdom. And when we align our wish, our heart's desire, with God's will, the likelihood of being granted that wish increases. Well, good morning, friends, and welcome to our Eagle's Nest online service. If you've never tuned in to eaglesnest.ch, and this is the first time you've been here, we are so glad you found us. We invite all of our guests to send us an email to hello@eaglesnest.ch so that we can say hello back. To all of you watching, please take a few moments to explore our website and get to know more about Eagle's Nest Ministries. You can play your favorite worship sets, listen to previous sermons, and discover how you can serve in one of our many ministries. Graduation season is upon us, and Eagle's Nest has a yearly tradition of honoring all of our graduates for all of your hard work. And this year, 2021, has been just as challenging as last with COVID restrictions and distance learning for our students. If you have someone, whether they're graduating from high school or college, that you wish to recognize, we're planning to have a graduate recognition ceremony on Sunday, June 13th. So if that's you, please send in your information to hello@eaglesnest.ch, include information about your graduate and a photo, and we will start working with you to make sure we honor that accomplishment. Have you heard about and checked out This Is My Story? Our production crew is busy capturing God moments as told through the lives of Eagle's Nest family members. These short video testimonials are a real treat, and they launch every Monday on our online campus. Our women's ministry, known as Divine Design, has many ways to connect our ladies as well. The next up for them is the ladies' golf tournament. They're going to play 9 holes at the Shamrock Par 3 right in our backyard coming up Saturday, May 22nd. And we encourage all ladies to sign up, even if you've never played golf before. It's a lot of fun. Middle schoolers, You've been talking a little bit about your program getting back and running. We're playing a special event just for you next month in the month of June. I'll get you more details next week, I promise, as we work on a strategy to reopen our live middle school program. High school students, Matt Windsor leads our local Young Life program and would love to have your high schooler join in. That's 8th through 12th grade. They gather right here at Eagle's Nest on Mondays at 7:02 p.m. And yes, you heard right, the rumors are true. We have announced and are diligently working to prepare to reopen Eagle's Nest Kids live on Sunday mornings. We're asking all Eagle's Nest parents to go into Realm and sign up your child, nursery through fifth grade. Eagle's Nest Kids Live opens in 3 weeks. That's Sunday, June 6th. Guys, we also offer many ways for you to stay connected. We'd like you to sign up for these events as you can. Last week, we shot some sporting clays. Next up is bowling night. 6 p.m. at Milford Lanes, Thursday, May 20th. And don't forget to pre-register for those events, as well as our chartered fishing trips. We have one later this month and one in June as well. Also, guys, our men's breakfast is scheduled for Saturday, June 5th at 8 a.m. in the cafeteria. Please register now and bring a friend. We're continuously blessed at Eagle's Nest and amazed by the generosity of our Eagle's Nest congregation. We want to thank all of you for supporting our ministry in all the ways that you do. There are two primary ways to give to Eagle's Nest with just a few clicks. The online method is super easy and secure. Go to eaglesnest.ch, click the Give tab, or you can mail in your gift using the address at the bottom of the webpage. We all know that life is stressful out there. People of all ages struggling with coping with all of those stressors. If you would like pastoral care or prayer for any reason, please don't go it alone. Reach out to us, send us an email to hello@eaglesnest.ch and let us connect with you. I want to thank you again for joining us today on our online campus. We encourage you to spend time reading 1 Kings along with us as we find these nuggets of wisdom from the wisest man in the world. We welcome you to return to Eagle's Nest to our 9:30 live services with us as well. Many of you have shared with us there is no substitute for gathering together on Sunday. We hope to see all of you live or online right back here next week as we continue the journey into the life of King Solomon. Have a great week, everyone. Take care.